Hey everyone, how's it going? This is your host Yoshino, and you're listening to episode number 166 with Stephen Assael, who is a painter and artist based in New York, interviewed by my friend, guest interviewer, John Wentz. And John's with us right now, and we're also doing a Swapcast episode in conjunction with John's podcast, the Lo-Fi Podcast. So definitely go check them out at lofipodcast.com or listen to them wherever you listen to your podcasts. And how's it going, John? How are you doing?
Doing great, man. Thank you.
So what did you learn from this interview, and did you learn anything in particular about Stephen's process that you didn't know before?
I mean, technically, I knew a lot about his process. What I think I really walked away with that I didn't know was the amount of thought that's put into his work. And I don't mean just from a formal perspective, but also, and you'll hear in the interview, from a philosophical perspective. He's a kind of, I guess you could say, like a consummate thinker in his approach to painting and how painting and life for him kind of intertwine.
Yeah, and I think you guys gave some pretty interesting examples of that. He was talking about Edward Hopper and how the scenes that he painted were very much an observation of his surroundings and a reflection of New York at that time period.
Yeah, I think so. And it was also, I think what I took away from it is his honesty and his earnesty in his painting. And that's kind of what I took away when he was saying how he reflected his surroundings. It was a type of being genuine, or a way of being genuine. And that also, to me, is reflective in Stephen's work. For example, like one of the things I had been dying to ask him, because he's actually was an art hero of mine back in art school.
Oh, wow.
And yeah, so this was really a you know, for lack of better words, a special thing for me. And I was particularly drawn to his work. It was in the late 90s, early 2000s, because he was doing, I guess, figurative works, multi-compositional, like multi-figure works and portraits of, you know, what you would, we back then we just called the subculture. So it's kind of, in a way, you can see some of that, and in no way am I really comparing them, but like Sean Cheatham's work, where, you know, it's like portraits of, you know, punk rockers and stuff. And that's what Stephen was doing back then. And, but when I saw his work in art school, you didn't see traditional realists, you know, to use that term, doing anything like that. So it really stuck out to me. And it was very original. And it was also reflective of my past. And what I thought was great. So I always wanted to ask him what drew him to that. And the story that you'll hear about it, I thought was fantastic. And it was just him being earnest. It was his early days in New York. That was the scene, you know, in the early 80s was the the transition from punk rock into no wave. So there was a lot of those type of no wave kids, punk rock kids, and I guess party kids. The rave scene was starting super early there or whatever. So yeah, it was great.
Shout out to No Wave.
With an H.
Anyways. Yeah. With an H. Yeah. Japanese heritage. Anyways, man. So, before we begin this episode, I'd like to give a quick shout out to Savoir Faire, who is a sponsor of ours, Decoded, and also someone that John, that you work with, I know. Maybe do you want to talk a bit about your experience working with Sennelier Paints, who is a brand that works in conjunction with Savoir Faire?
Yeah, Sennelier I actually started using even back in school. So this is kind of a great thing for me as well to kind of be working with them. And I always stuck with them. Usually it was at first with higher chroma colors, cadmiums and things like that, because the pigment load is really good. And then I just started using all my paints, even earth colors and stuff like that, because across the board, I think the pigment load, you know, in ratio to what the cost is really, really good. And then there's particular colors that I've kind of stuck with that I don't want to say you can't get in other brands, but they're in particular work really well for me in Sennelier. Like for one is I use Bonnard Blue, which is a type of, I guess you compare it to cerulean, but it's the way it works in conjunction, like with something like a cad red light, you can get these really amazing grays. And then I've really loved like Viridian and Alizarin is another two of my favorites with them. It's all about, for me, getting grays. And so that's what I love about the paints is I can go from a high chroma to really, really wonderful grays with just a couple of colors.
Hmm. Well, amazing, man. Yeah. Well, thanks so much for doing this podcast, and really appreciate you for interviewing Steven. And I liked listening to your interview with him. And yeah, everyone definitely go check out John's podcast. That's lofipodcast.com, or you can listen to it wherever you listen to your podcast. And also, before we begin the episode, I'd like for everyone, if you can, go to our iTunes page, both of our iTunes pages, John's and mine, and smash that 5-star review, smash that sucker right in its starry-eyed little head, and leave us a review. Hopefully, not a nasty review. We don't like nasty reviews, right, John?
Yeah, just the good ones. Keep that 5-star going.
Yeah, just the good ones. I'm actually, I have a report directly to Apple to take off all the nasty reviews. So if you leave one, I'll report you. And I'm probably going to cut that part out. But anyways, all right. All right, man. Well, thanks for doing this, man. And, you know, always a pleasure.
It was a lot of fun. It was a great honor to talk to Steve, and I had a lot of fun with it. So thanks for the opportunity.
Definitely, man. Definitely. All right, well, here it is. Without further ado, Artist Decoded episode number 166 with Steven Assael, interviewed by painter John Wentz. Hope you enjoy.
And where are you located now?
I'm in Paris.
Oh, wow.
For the time being.
That's a nice place to be.
It's not bad. It's not bad if you're a painter. That's for
yes.
sure.
And how is it there? Is it you're under lockdown there as well? Or?
Yeah, we are. We just entered phase 2 about a week or so ago, which means still no museums, which is terrible because right when this started, I just came off a load of work. And so I had just planned to like spend a day at the D'Orsay, and I was going to go to the Louvre again. And then literally the next day was the lockdown. So this means for us phase 2 is no gatherings. Well, you can't go into restaurants, so they open the terrace, which you probably know, you've been to Paris, for the French is a major thing, so that but still a lot of things are closed down.
I see.
How much do you think your painting practice has affected your patients and your patients with this?
Well, you know, I think that there's something, I think that with every kind of disadvantage, there are advantages. And it's the thing is to try to sort of, you know, seek out what those advantages are and make use of them. I mean, having this conversation right now, I wouldn't probably otherwise be talking with you, be in my studio painting right now.
Right.
But it's I think in some ways in a very strange interesting way in which we're all separated, we're also kind of brought together. You know, there's a kind of way in which we're communicating with each other. I think that has changed, some for the good, some maybe not so much for the good, but. But I do think that there's kind of an intimacy that allows for the way we speak to each other by virtue of Zoom and the online kinds of means in which we talk to each other now.
Right.
So having this recording, I think in many ways for me I've only done one other podcast, so this is my second podcast, and I think that there's for me just a little bit of strangeness to it, but at the same time I'm trying to sort of overcome the idea that it's an extension of our use of technology, and that I'd like to think about you actually being there in the room with me instead. You know,
is that the same, because something I've always taken away from your work, and funny enough, your working methods, which, I mean, it seems strange to say that they're part and parcel to each other, but yours are in a different way to me, in just that sense of when I've seen, and it's only by virtue of video that I've ever seen you work with a model, there seems to be a very different level of intimacy than I've seen with certain artists' work. It's almost as if you know, there's that feel with some artists that it just becomes subject. It's just artist and subject. And I think I've even heard you refer to them as maybe even actors, or, you know, they become so much more part of the process. So it seems like you're always in this or after certain intimacy with people, whether it just be conversation or with painting. Is that off?
Well, I when you think about it, how a director kind of directs his actors, you director might have a construct, you know, or an idea for what he wants, you know, from the players, the actors who are playing a role. But essentially, I think that a good director kind of relinquishes some of that direction and allows the actor's influence to intervene in the process. And so when you have a person or, you know, another person in the room with you while you're painting, there's some of that goes on. There's a bit of interruption that one can embrace in the idea that you might have originally had. So we start a picture very often with kind of a concept or a feeling for what we want. And we have a picture of it in our mind with regard to what we want. But sometimes it's good to sort of like let some of that go and still make use of it in terms of the sort of overall, you know, thread of a picture. But to allow some interruption, to allow some surprise in the dynamic of a picture's development. And a lot of that for me comes from the a direct human connection with the person who's sitting for me. And that, you know, no matter who that person is, if it's somebody that I'm very close to, or if it's someone who, you know, I don't know at all, there's a kind of an energy and a unraveling of oneself. And I think that we do in many ways, you know, paint ourselves when we're painting others. But I do think that others, the presence of another, also influences how we kind of direct ourselves at what it is that we see. And it's an interesting kind of triangulation that develops between the person sitting for you and how you are, what you are, and what the picture becomes. And I think that it's in that rhythm of allowing, you know, the sitter very often to show something or reveal something or to surprise you in some ways. And one can say that's also part of the actual experience painting, that the time itself that interrupts the process, that the layering of sequence and movement can influence the direction that a picture can go. So I like to sort of allow for change. And it's in those moments of change that I can select and decide what essentially becomes meaningful in a picture. And one other thing too is that selection, or the idea of selecting, is both objective and also subjective. So there's inner kind of dictionary that I like to say, kind of a visual vocabulary that we develop as observers that becomes kind of internalized, and it's almost like the recording that has to do with our own history, our own understanding of things, our own awareness of visual aesthetics, you know, and what we like and what we dislike, what appeals to us, what doesn't. And so we're reaching inward in selectively, as well as reaching outward selectively, to find kind of an equilibrium or a balance with regard to how we express what it is that matters to us. If that makes any sense.
No, that makes perfect sense. Yeah. Immediately that comes to mind is then, when you go from, let's say, like a single figure drawing to a large, I mean, you have pieces over 8 feet, multi-figure. how to go about that kind of relinquishing. Because then, is that what you're saying? Like, you may go in and say it's a large 8-foot multi-figure painting. You have your idea pretty set out, but you're still allowing room for change.
Absolutely. That? Yes. Yeah. I mean, a lot of times I mean, for my students, I've been traveling more or less around the country and across the globe quite a bit lately. And I mean, now that we, you know, I'm teaching more and more on Zoom, and I've been doing individual critiques with artists from this country, but also all around the world now, which I wouldn't have otherwise. So it's interesting to see other artists working in other areas, other regions, and be able to sort of provide those artists with advice and introspection that they could take, you know, with regard to how they see their own work and how they think about their work. So it's an interesting opportunity for people to be able to sort of like connect with other artists now that maybe they wouldn't have otherwise. So these individual critiques are sort of an example of how I'm connecting with other people and their worlds and what they think and what my thoughts can provide and help them with. But the connection that I'm trying to sort of make here is that by allowing others to sort of like filter in, like, you know, a good teacher doesn't just provide answers, but is also kind of allowing the students to find the right questions in their work and guiding them in some way to finding those questions, what matters to them. And in the same way, when I have a model in my studio or I'm working with or without a model, or I'm developing a picture, I'm trying to find the right questions, you know, trying to ask the right questions of myself, what it is that becomes important. So I might have an idea ahead of time that's strategic with regard to what I want, but it's really the experience itself that motivates change and motivates a renewal of what some of the things that we think we want might not really be exactly what we want. You know, often I tell my students that when making a drawing, for example, like, you know, when we can draw sort of like from the whole art, from the part to the whole, how we think about the particular in relation to the larger picture at hand, or the emphasis of what it is that we want, you know, in the big picture of things, or in the big, you know, the largeness of what it is. And I tell them, well, you know, it's kind of like taking a trip cross country. You know, you have an itinerary, you have a plan, you mapped out where you want to go, what you think those locations might be for, you know, with regard to where your final destination will, and what that final destination would look like and become. And so one sort of like travels, you know, from New York, let's say, to, you know, New Jersey, Spain, Ohio, and so forth, till you get to maybe your ultimate destination, California. And you have this sort of in your mind what it's going to be. But then until you actually take the trip, you know, you bypass certain areas that are not of as much interest, because you don't know what matters until you're there.
That's a perfect analogy. Yeah.
You know, so once you're in the journey, you know, then we're selecting, you know, you're taking and discarding, you know, emphasizing, de-emphasizing, you know, what, and a lot of that is, like I said, is kind of connected to the internal language that we've established by virtue of what we know, you know, our dictionary, you know, you could say, and, mm-hmm. and it's also open to surprise of the experience itself. So it's in that sort of balance of the two that I think that we kind of like, I'm always looking for a surprise to myself, you know, like something that I found that I'd never seen or done before that in my painting. How something sort of like flies through the air, that bit of paint hits the surface a certain way. And it's like, wow, okay. You know, it's like flying through the air and hitting hitting that surface where you want it to go, you know, but it, you know, and it's like, wow, there it is, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
And so it's not so predictable, you know, it's just sort of like, you want to be able to sort of incite that element of unpredictability, in the process, you know, and that kind of makes it like what makes something feel alive, I think, and makes the experience alive. If that makes any sense.
No, it does. And actually the way you ended that, it reminded me of, what's that book? The Practice of Science and Drawing by Harold Speed. Mm-hmm. I'm not familiar with that book. And he talks about that in a roundabout way, about always avoiding perfection and kind of creating those situations of exploration for yourself and mm-hmm. kind of keep it fresh, because that communicates to the viewer, mm-hmm. you know, in all respects. Mm-hmm. But how much of that for you is intellectual versus emotional, or like a gut instinct?
Well, I think that the when we talk about kind of an internalized, like, visual vocabulary, you know, how that vocabulary, you know, the more, you know, technically, I think that the more we learn, the broader the dictionary becomes, you know, the more words, the more understanding, the more use of terms become broader and broader and broader, you know. But you know, I tell my students, you know, like when you're drawing and painting, you're not copying that dictionary. You know, right. You have to choose the right words to make poetry out of it. You know, so even though the language can be very broad and the knowledge can be very broad, you know, you can have a very strong, you know, like very, very dramatic range of light and shadow or tone and pitch, you know, but it's the right, it's taking, extracting, you know, the right combination of words from what we know in accordance with what we see, that in my thinking makes something not unique but also united in its feeling, but makes it like poetry, you know, makes it mm-hmm. you want that poetical, that semblance of things that don't feel like they should belong. The thing that happens, the spark that happens when we feel something and know something from our experiences that are contained within our own mind's eye, and the experiences that are happening, you know, simultaneous to that, sequentially in the moment, that I think that when they collide, when those things kind of collide, that one has to sort of like find the right pitch. And I think that for me, it's about that rhythm, finding that rhythm, you know, that thread of connectedness, that becomes a very exciting thing. So in many ways, like a painting, you know, a painting is not so much. Now this is my own, you know, my own personal feeling, is that it's not so much the end product, but it's really kind of the experience itself that. In many ways becomes the performance, you know, the action, the moment that in my mind overrides what we get, what the outcome. And even though the outcome might in many ways be a remnant of that and show something of that, whether it's successful or not successful, it's for me, the excitement comes in the action, and it's the action itself that the meaning is truly materialized, not mm-hmm. in the relic of that, or in the subsequent object that we make. I don't know if that makes any sense. I mean, it sounds a little bit mm-hmm.
Sounds perfect.
Yeah.
No. It's a great explanation, and it makes. I wondered, as you're saying that, I love the way you talk about drawing. Or just art in general being, you know, this process of selection and exaggeration of what it is you're trying to express. When was it for you that you made that transition? Because I feel most of us starting out drawing, it's this act of mimetics where we're just, you know, we're learning and we're copying as kids or whenever it is. Mm-hmm. And then there comes a time, maybe it's a good teacher, maybe it's, I don't know, something you saw, where mm-hmm. you start to let go and start to express, and you learn that quality. Do you recall when that transition was for you?
I mean, it's very hard to remember, go back, but I do, in terms of like, well, you know, when, how I think about drawing and when I start to draw and what I think, you know, what, where it kind of, shaped my, I mean, I think that drawing in many ways is kind of like every, you know, it's where it all begins, right, when we're children, and how we, think about things, you know, when we're children. I think that there's something we all share, you know, as kids when we start to draw. I think that copying is something that, you know, kind of like relying on what we see, by, you know, it has to do a lot with sort of the reaching out for what it is that we love, want, and what we also want to sort of like capture, you know. It's like capturing something from the outside. Why do we do that? You know, why when we're children do we want to draw a cat that we love, or our dog, or our pet? You know, or what is it about that feeling, you know, that makes us want to sort of hold it, you know? And I think as children we feel so powerless, and there's an element of assuming control as a child. By copying what one sees, or by trying to give it permanence, you know, giving something that's impermanent permanence. You know, there's not just control, but there's an element, almost a feeling of power in that. And I think that when we, if we think back to our own childhood, what that felt like, that can be an really interesting dynamic in the way we think about ourselves drawing, you know, what we see, because you want to be able to sort of like give the temporal, you know, the thing that's going to move, the thing that's going to change, you want to hold it forever, you know. And the reason I think we want to hold it forever is because it takes a kind of love for the world, for the things that we see, that makes us want to do that, you know. And it's kind of in that loving of things visual that allows for that power, that feeling of power and presence. And I think there's something very uniquely human about that as human beings. Mm-hmm. But I think that, you know, just in terms of like, you know, developing one's skills, I do know that, like, when I was younger, I was taught. I studied a little bit with Robert Beverly Hale, and also with Gustav Rehberger, and some of the artists that were teaching in New York at the Art Students League in the 1970s when I was a kid, you know. And I was never taught to measure, you know. I was never taught to literally sit there with calipers and measure everything out, because I was told that by doing that you know, it becomes an impediment to the source of the drawing, you know, to the gesture, to the feeling of spontaneity, or the idea that the drawing needs to sort of like start with the living line, or the principal line, as Delacroix called it, the energy of the drawing. So to start first with that thread of that line, that dominant line of movement and gesture, and then to work your proportions from that, but to work the proportions not by measuring, but to work those proportions based on the idea and feeling and what becomes more, again, it's selectively important, you know. So depending on the gesture, depending on the drawing, one would acclimate the proportions to that. So so the expressive quality of the drawing is what matters, not the exact proportion.
Right. Even with Hale, I find, you remember.
Well, not so much. Hale was very kind of didactic in his approach. Yeah. You know, I remember as a little kid. Also, Hale was very, I mean, for a young kid, very hard, you know, he talked in this drone-like voice, and was very kind of, very hard to make it exciting, you know. but I think that what I remember with him was that you would do his drawing. And I remember drawing like the model and trying to copy all of the bumps on the back or the muscles without really knowing much about the underlying structure. And he would come by and put a piece of tracing paper on your drawing and then really show you, you know, where the bones were and the muscle groupings were. And by understanding what was underneath, a young mind starts to say, oh my gosh, that makes so much more sense, you know? Yeah. And so the knowing, how to see something, it is more important than just copying what one sees, because knowing gives you sort of the way of penetrating the surface, the way of seeing something for what something is in its dimension, as opposed to just its flatness, you know,
right.
or what we would see on the surface. And so the idea that, you know, what becomes of, you know, people say, you know, draw what you know, not what you see, or draw what you see, not what you know. It becomes a bit of a semantic issue, because it's really a bit of both, you know, because what we see in my mind is what we know, and what we know is what we see. But the penetrating, or the being able to see through something with one's imagination and one's mind's eye, and the imagination becomes connected to what it is that we know about something. So even when we're looking at color, or observing color relationships, or observing, you know, I mean, I think about color and drawing as being the same, you know, for example, not to separate color from drawing, but even if you're making a drawing in tone or in value, still to see it as color, because it's what gives it, it's what takes it away from just the surface. You're able mm-hmm. to see and feel atmosphere that way, even though you're drawing only in tone. But the idea that atmosphere itself, the thickness of the air from one point to another, how that air feels, how we want to like move from one spot to another optically, and at the same time be able to sort of understand how to see through something, you know.
I see.
So proportion to me is a lot of things. It's not just getting, you know, the right scale of the foot to the knee, to the head, you know, and so forth, or measuring, you know, counting heads down to the foot. I mean, it can be all of that, and it's good to know all of that, but not to be sort of not to allow too much of that to inhibit or control the drawing.
All right. You did. I remember a quote you had once that was, it was an interview, and you were saying, what I mean by proportion is the way that I think about measurement of shapes and how those shapes as forms are understood in my representation of an image. And what I found fascinating about that is you didn't say anything about relation. You say understood. So is that kind of what you're getting at?
Well, I think that, you know, how we see shape-to-shape relationships, as opposed to, you know, a lot of times students draw sort of like looking at contour, and they're uh-huh. measuring, you know, like the shape of the leg based on sort of the contour. Well, you know, a contour is simply an extension of how we understand the internal you know, volumes pushing out.
Yeah, it's like shorthand.
You know, so, you know, I mean, you know, as we know, you know, there are no lines in nature, but, you know, when we make a line, it's basically, you know, symbolic of how we express and how we think about the internal forms, you know. So thinking about sort of the bigger shape, you know, at hand in your mind, being able to sort of project it when you are drawing that contour, you know, allows for not only the expression of that contour, but how we understand and see in our mind's eye those internal volumes. What is it that Aang once said, that the muscles of the body are like the weave of a basket that bulge forth from the inside out? And so if you think about, like, you know, Aang is drawing like the contour, so focused on the beauty of that line and how the contour
it's amazing.
The contour is just so like elegant and so incredibly expressed, you know. But he's not seeing the line when he's drawing it. He's seeing the form, you know.
Mm-hmm.
He's seeing and feeling the form because he could see it in his head, you know, the form. Not because he has to draw all of the muscles and all of the forms, but by virtue of the contour, you know, and the simple simple elegance of a line, how he makes it, can say so much about those internal volumes, you know, and how we think about like the explosion of those volumes from the inside out, as opposed to, you know, like a lot of academic points of view, or like, you know, you kind of start with the envelope, and, you know, you start with sort of the perimeter, the form, and then you simply fill in.
Right.
Or the sort of idea of the window shade effect, you know, starting, mm-hmm. you know, from one point to another. Well, I think that, like, in some ways, Aang did that, but it was only because he had a really strong sense of, like, what was happening on the inside, you know? And it's almost like he had eyes that could project, you know, what was there before he could draw it. You know, he knew exactly what was where things were going to go. He also said that the mark of a great draftsman was to start with the left foot and draw up, yeah. you know? So it's like, if you could start with the left foot, just draw up, you know, it's like you could see everything already there before you actually draw it. You can select what matters before because you can see it, you know, you can see it in your mind already. So that sort of approach, is one approach but it's also based on sort of the feeling and the idea that classical form is a vessel, you know, the idea of a basket, even like the weave of a basket, the overlapping shapes, you know, or overlapping muscles, curvatures that overlap, that bulge forth from the inside if you think about like a Greek vase, you know, what is, mm-hmm. what is that? You know, it's a container of space. So form is a container of space, and it simultaneously occupies space. And what it does is that it's finding the bigness of that shape, the feeling of a fullness of that shape that makes something feel alive, you know, and present. And that feeling of fullness of form is what makes something breathe as well. You know, it breathes out, you know, breathes out into the space. And so, you know, like when you're thinking about giving that feeling of breath to form, you know, think about overlapping bulging forms as opposed to, you know, forms that are concave. Think about the convex shapes that fill the space. So it's, again, it's about seeing sort of like seeing proportion, not so much as a surface characteristic, but seeing proportion as being an internal idea, you know, an internalized idea of shape. It's not just measuring accurately, it's feeling the form as shape, you know, how that shape moves, speaks to the eye, but also breathes in its own space. So, you know, when we think about, like Degas once said that we can't breathe the air of the great paintings of the old masters, you know, it's not an air that we breathe. It's not where, it's not our air, you know, it's not the air of reality. It's another kind of air, but yet it is an air, you know, it has mm-hmm. air, you know, which is kind of interesting. It's just a wonderful thing to think about. Because when you think about making a painting, you know, I often think about like, well, a painting can feel like it's moving and alive and feel like it's like it really has its own space, its own place, its own like dimension, you know, and it's sometimes, you know, and so it can be, you know, we can look into a picture as a window. But a picture can also kind of reverberate and extend itself into our space. It also has dimension that we both look into and also, you know, penetrates into our space. And I think that's kind of an interesting idea that the air, you know, has its own, you know, in other words, like its own set of laws, you know, that every artist creates his own kind of set of laws. And his own judgment based on, you know, those laws or those principles. But at the same time, it's invasive, you know, it invades our space. Was it John Dewey who once said that a work of art is like an organ of vision? And this is kind of like a funny thing because I think it's true in many ways, at least in my looking at other artists' work and how it shapes the way we see the world, you know? I don't know if you've ever gone to a museum show and then come out and looked at the world and said, oh my gosh, that looks like, you know, an Edward Hopper painting.
Or, yeah, absolutely.
You know, or, oh my gosh, that looks like, yeah, like a, you know, a Vermeer, you know? And I mean, there's so many times that that's happened, and I can clearly remember those moments, you know? I remember that we had a show of Vermeer at Metropolitan Museum, and many, you know, good example, a good variety of his paintings. Some of them I, you know, were from the Met. Many of them I've seen before, but having them all kind of in one space, beautifully lit. They had the Milkmaid brought in from the Rijksmuseum. I remember it was kind of a winter day and we had our coats checked, coat room, and went going back to get my coat, the coat room, and just observing someone, a young woman putting her jacket on, and the way her gesture, like kind of head tipped to the light that was coming from kind of the side and the right. I mean, and it was like I could, it was like time stopped in that moment, seeing that person just putting their jacket on, this sort of casual gesture. I mean, it was like looking at Vermeer's astronomer, you know, in that moment, you know, caught and made permanent. Just a simple moment, you know, that was Vermeer, you know. And it was like, oh my God. And I pointed it out to my friend, you know, just, look at that. Oh my God, that's a Vermeer, you know. So it wasn't just It wasn't just my thing, you know. It was like,
yeah,
it was infectious, you know. So the idea that a great work of art is infectious, you know, infects the viewer, invades our space, makes us feel what they feel, makes us see what they see, you know, is really quite miraculous. And I don't know, it's happened many times, you know, with many, after seeing many shows, you know, that, and I kind of look forward to that, because I look forward to finding that, reviving that kind of experience, you know. I mean, it could be looking at a group of paintings that are coming out of a show of Monet, and then all of a sudden just walking into the brightly lit street, you know, and start looking, you know, just looking down at the ground and all of the debris on the ground, and all of a sudden just seeing it, you know, like Monet saw it. I think that thinking about making a picture, not just by copying what we see, but inspiring others to see a certain way very often is more important.
Yeah. And on that topic, I mean, it's that you bring up Hopper too, is even here in Paris, what amazes me is when it's not just the look of an artist, but the feel, like somebody like Hopper, who was just so good at capturing that feeling of I don't know, some would say melancholy or isolation or this mm-hmm. and that. And I've had moments here in Paris where it was just a certain feel, a certain atmosphere that felt so Hopper-esque.
Right. Especially now, right? I mean, New York City now feels like a Hopper, one big giant Hopper painting.
Yeah.
Which, you know, and it's interesting because I think that Hopper is a good example of someone who kind of, I think that his vision was so natural to how he felt that it doesn't feel at all self-conscious, you mm-hmm. know? And I don't think that he was really consciously trying to portray the world that way, but he just felt it that way. You know?
Right. Yeah. And, I feel like that, you know, earnesty is kind of comes off.
Yeah. But it's also like something that that somehow like he was so sensitive to how modern world felt, you know, for him, you know, how it affected his mind's eye, that I don't think that he said to himself, well, I'm going to make this feel this way. You know, he just painted mm-hmm. it, you know, because that's just the way he saw things, you know. I came across a quote by Baudelaire. It says that romanticism is not a choice of subject, but a way of looking at reality from within.
Perfect.
You know, that in many ways, like kind of like a romantic outlook is, I think that's something that is that not so much like, you know, the way we think of the word, you know, romantic, but But the nature of romanticism is that idea that there's an internalized world. And actually Schopenhauer once said, I have a quote here from him. He said that for each of us, the world is not a sun or an earth, but instead an eye that sees the sun and a hand that feels the earth, making the world about us our idea of the world. So it's sort of like the world is not the world, but the world is my idea of the world, is a way of sort of internalizing, you know, the language that you could think about it this way, sort of a way of internalizing the language of seeing, but also how to project that idea of the internal. And at the same time, for me, it isn't just that it isn't just, at least for me, you know, it isn't just a romantic outlook, but it's also believing in the world of appearances, and believing that I can make assumptions about that world. You know, I can assume that world exists and is fixed to a certain degree, you know, and so it's in that kind of like balance that being a, you know, representational painter becomes so important to me. That I maintain that idea of representation, and because there's an element of both doubt and faith associated with each other about the world that one can feel, and I think that from, you know, at least for me, you know, I can't speak for everyone because it isn't something that we all necessarily believe, you know, but for me that the belief in the relationship between what I accept and what I assume in that acceptance, you know, optically, visually, is also an assumption of faith. Because I could disprove everything, you know, if by reason. I could disprove that, you know, I can hold up a pencil like Hegel didn't. What is this? You know, can anybody yeah. explain it to me? You know, and so one can sort of like disprove our the world optically, you know. But I think that going back to that idea of being a child, that we make that assumption that the world is there and the world is something can be denoted as beautiful. You know, we can say that the world, the things that we see, you know, can relish in those things, and we can say that they are beautiful. And I think that, the idea of beauty is something that, you know, maybe in contemporary times we don't think often of, you know, mm-hmm. but, you know, it was another, like, what is it that Schopenhauer said, that, you know, a work of art is like a raging tiger trapped in a beautiful silver cage.
Right. Right.
You know, so the idea is that beauty is form is the way that we give form to the horror of existence. You know, that existence is time, you know, is, you know, nature wants to devour us, you know. But we can still embrace it and give it in that beautiful silver cage, you know. And we embrace it and make it this very romantic idea. Schopenhauer's a ring.
It was,
but yeah. we can embrace it and give it form, you know, and make it beautiful, you know.
Right. I also heard you speak before about, we were talking about working from life, and you referred to it as, I believe, as like an inquiry into humanness. Is that correct?
Well, I think that it's an inquiry into very often your own humanness, you know. As opposed to like, I like, you know, and even, well, I mean, like really, we don't really, I mean, we really don't know anything. You don't, when somebody sits in your studio, you know, and you're painting and drawing them, do you really get to know that person? No.
Right.
You know, not really. Do you, even the people who are close to you and who love you, you know, and you love them, you know something about that, but do you really know them? No, not really. And then you have to say to yourself, do I really know myself even?
Yeah.
You know,
true.
You know, so, you know, so that sort of, like, very often I kind of say, like, the that there's kind of a price for beauty. As far as reason goes, beauty is really an impossibility.
Mm-hmm.
It just only appears to be harnessed by reason.
Yeah.
So that idea of appearances and what is real becomes a dilemma. Does that make any sense?
Yeah, I think so.
And it's kind of like in that dilemma that one can sort of like find something about themselves, you know? In other words, that like, and they just had on TV a documentary on Bruce Lee. I love Bruce Lee.
Oh yeah, I'm a big fan.
He's such a great, like, I mean, what I love about Bruce Lee is what he says, you know? He says so many great things. I mean, he's so interesting, like really. I mean, the way he thinks about, systems, you know, even, and breaking the system, you know, and creating surprise is just like, it's painting, you know, it's just like painting. He once said that, I think it might've been in Into the Dragon, I'm not sure, but to release yourself from the burden of your mind.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Young people, you know? Yeah. And it's like the thinking can get in the way of the doing, you know? So I tell my students, I said, you know, think, but then forget about your thinking and then just do it.
Yeah.
You know?
Otherwise, I always refer to that as like analysis into paralysis. It's the same thing. Mm-hmm. You can analyze over and over until finally you just paralyze yourself.
Absolutely. Like overthinking.
Stuff. Yeah. Yeah.
But I think it's important to think a lot about what it is that you're doing. You know, step back. That's why we step back. We make judgments, you know. And that's really important to be able to gain objectivity with ourselves and with what we see and what we want. But there's kind of a price to be paid for that. You know, the price is that it's not the action.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the action itself is something else.
Right.
You know, it's like, Baryshnikov probably thought about how to take that flying leap, thought about it, practiced it. But that extra few seconds that he's like, you know, defying gravity, that he's in the air longer than he's supposed to be, the illusion that he creates in doing that, you know, is true skill, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Like that's real skill, you know. Skill is not the techniques that you learn and adapt to and make use of alone, but it's how you transform it into the action.
Right.
You know, how you transform the knowledge into the action. And so, you know, he takes that flying leap. He's not thinking.
That's virtuosity. Yeah.
You know, he's not thinking. He's just doing it. And it's just like happening.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it looks perfect.
Yeah. And flawless. And that's
flawless.
Virtuosity.
Yeah. 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 And so that's how I think about skill.
Okay.
You know, that's people, you know, when I was in college, people like talk that, you know, it's too skillful or, you know, get, you know, what, you know, it's certain, connotations that people use with words that kind of denote a negativity, you know, like skillfulness was like looked at as being negative.
Yeah. It was a pejorative,
you know, like, yeah. And so like, why is it, why is it a bad thing? You know, like what does it even mean? What does skill really mean anyway? So, you know, questioning semantics in the words as a young artist, you know, is very important to me. And so like, idea of like, you know, rebelling and questioning is something that I still do. I still want to question. I still want to think about things in a way that, you know, is not necessarily accepting. You know, I don't accept everything, you know. So there's, you know, having a visual outlook on the world that accepts and doesn't accept,
mm-hmm.
you know, is, in my mind, is like really, for me, is sort of like teeters on that in that balance. What becomes, you know, an affirmation, and what becomes a, you know, kind of a, you know, an unresolved question, you know,
mm-hmm.
And sometimes the unresolved question becomes more important, because that becomes in many ways the mystery of a painting.
That's the intrigue. You know, so, yeah.
The mystery of something. And so people say, well, how do you find your own language, or how do you find your own vision of the thing? You know, and the best way to do that is just to sort of not think too much about yourself, you know, release yourself from the burden of your mind.
Yeah. Back to Bruce Lee.
You know, release yourself from the burden of your mind and just be, you know, just exist and look at, and just, you know, be part of this thing, you know, but question it and be involved in it, be outward and inward.
Yeah.
I don't know if that makes sense.
Yeah, no, it does. And I feel it seems, I know for myself, my experience too, it seems for a lot of people, it's extremely difficult to let go of that, because you put so much stock into this idea of whatever you think skill is, and to let go of that skill. Like, for instance, you know, recently I've going back to some jazz albums, and, you know, from Miles Davis and especially Coltrane, like going through Coltrane to Giant Steps into The Love Supreme, into Ascension, you know, you can argue that he's, and many have, that it was skillless in some ways, but that letting go, there was a skill within that as well.
Yes, absolutely. You know? That's great. That's a great
point. And I feel like when you're talking about flinging paint, that's almost how I see Coltrane, especially in A Love Supreme. He was still a little bit hanging on there, you know, but there were moments of just let go that, you know.
Yes. Yeah. It's the nature in some ways of improvisation, is that, allowing the element of chance to sort of become part of it, you know, allowing chances. Some people don't believe in a chance universe. What is it? Einstein said that God doesn't play dice with the universe.
Yeah, yeah.
But Heisenberg does the opposite.
Right.
With the uncertainty principle. But there's in my mind, I think about it as both those things. You know, that all of this is composed of both. You know, it's both ordered and chaos. You know, it's not just our mind that imposes order on things, but there is order. And our mind does impose order as well. But and our mind also has chaos. You know? So I think that there's a combination of both. And it's how we make use of it. It's how we make use of the chaos. And it's how we make use of the order, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think that there's something about our creative nature. I mean, you know, like, what is human nature? Like, our ability to reason and our ability to make things, you know, be creative.
Imagination, yeah.
You know, an imagination. So the combination of what our, you know, in terms of like our the nature of being human is such a fascinating thing, you know. It's just so crazy and unique, and I don't know, being alive is, especially now, it's just like, what the hell is going on, you know? Well, you know, I mean, if you believe in a completely, causal existence, you know, that everything is deterministic, you know, then it's like, well, then the problem becomes, you know, like, where, you know, where is there freedom? You know, is there freedom? And in many ways, that sort of like, that became the philosophical conundrum, you know, especially at the turn of the century and during the Romantic period.
All right.
So, you know, like, so where do our choices, do we have free will? You know, do we have the freedom to choose? You know, comes question mark. If you believe in a completely deterministic universe, because then we're all predisposed to everything. You know, our choices are not really ours anymore. You know? So I mean, that's an interesting idea that you bring up, because throwing that little bit of chaos in is. I mean, I think the universe is composed more of chaos.
I would agree with you.
Yeah. But that idea of that little bit of chaos is a little bit like, in my mind, kind of like the little bit of miracle that breaks the rhythm, you know,
mm-hmm.
the little bit, the miracle that things, you know, anything can change, anything can happen. Not just because of what we do, you know, or our choices, but because the world can be that way.
Right.
Which it's an interesting way of thinking. You know, I think, you know, that there is that we have free will, you know, but that the world itself, that the universe itself might have a will of its own.
You know, something I was really interested about, because when I was telling you that in the beginning, when I was in art school, that's when I came across your work, and it was a big influence on me. And what stuck out to me is because the first body of work I saw of yours was when you were really getting into the body art subculture, because it was such a different thing to see at the time among realist artists. And I was always curious how that came about. What was your interest in that, and how did it come about? And what year was it? That was like the early 2000s, right? When you were doing
late 1990s.
Late 1990s, okay. So it was early 2000s.
In New York.
I came across
yeah.
it.
New York City was a different place. I think that, I mean, you know, you I don't know if you've been to New York.
Oh, yeah. I lived there for a little bit.
And I grew up here. Grew up in New York City, and so I sort of witnessed the change. It's become so much more commercialized and kind of, you know, sterile in its outlook. You know,
mm-hmm.
A lot. But back in the 90s, there are quite a few. That idea of the subculture under, you know, the and in the 80s as well, I mean, you know, it's come out in street art.
Oh, for sure, yeah.
You know, but that really doesn't exist anymore. It's too expensive now.
Yeah.
But, I mean, maybe it'll change after all this. Who knows? You know, maybe something.
Anything can happen.
Yeah.
But you look at Brooklyn, like in the last, you know, 10 years, mm-hmm. Brooklyn, Williamsburg.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So New York's become really kind of like a tourist attraction.
Right.
In recent years, well, not so recent, quite a while now. But back in, you know, I had once had a studio, 939 8th Avenue, right around the last year when I graduated from college. Me and a buddy of mine, we opened up a studio down right off of 56th Street on 8th Avenue,
uh-huh.
And we only paid $300 a month. For about 2,000 square feet.
Oh man, that's incredible!
Yeah, in Manhattan, you know, and we were able to you didn't need much money to live and get along in the city, you know.
Yeah.
And to be young and to be kids, it was a great time. You know, so much freedom, you know. But I mean, it was dangerous. Well, there's a lot more, you know, drug trafficking and crime and all kinds of. You know, things like that as well. So it can't be too romantic about it. You know? But it was also a time when, you know, there was this kind of free ability to kind of go anywhere, do anything, you know, feel restricted in any way, you know, as a young person, as a young artist.
Yeah.
So we could have people come into our studio and draw and paint, people would pose without having necessarily didn't mind not pay, even, you know, we had lots of people coming pose for us. We didn't have to pay. You know, people just wanted to, you know,
for
yeah.
Sure,
I mean,
yeah.
Like there was a Bihari Krishna temple at that time, just a few blocks away. We had no money. We would go there to eat, you know, have our dinner there and kind of go through it all and then have a free meal. And you know, they would always say, kind of proselytize a little bit here and there.
Sure.
So we made use of that. We got them to come pose for us.
What? That's amazing.
And so, you know, they'd come with their music, the drums and everything.
Yeah.
And they posed, they would, you know, kind of model for us in our studio. So, you know, anything you could do to get a person to model for you, pose for you, You know, we've kind of figured that out, how to do that, you know, and it was great because you could, like, you know, just meet all different kinds of people. New York is such a mixture of people, you know, and it was just so wonderful to be able to sort of be open to the variety of people and make them kind of connect to your world by virtue of how you allowed them into your studio. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, that I've always sort of had that idea that I started painting firemen because my neighbor was a lieutenant in New York City Fire Department back in the late 80s, early 90s. And he introduced me to more firemen who started modeling for me. They didn't want pay. They just wanted, you know, just wanted to model and be part of it, you know, and it was great, you know, just getting to know their world and connecting with their experiences in some way and bringing that into my stream of thinking. That's how, you know, I started connecting with some of these young kids at that time who were, you know, either goth kids or club kids. Mm-hmm. And they wanted to just model. They wanted to be, they loved to pose, you know. They'd love to see themselves made into a painting. Just, you know, so enthusiastic and so creative in their thinking. And so that kind of environment in New York was just very different than it is now. But it was also a great source of not just, you know, material to paint, think of it that way, or, you know, but also just to experience different ways of thinking that people had, and to make that kind of connection in the painting, you know. In other words, that, you know, like I mentioned earlier, that the actor is so important to me. Mm-hmm. That the person who's playing their role, you know, says something about what that role is, but then at the same time, you know, begins to reveal something of the of what you don't, you know, see right away. You know, there's a text and a subtext to everything.
Okay.
You know, and so the theatricality, and I mean theatricality is very important to me in general, the idea of theater, and a lot of the club kids, I think that the theatricality of assuming a new name, you know,
right,
creating a new name for themselves, body modification, changing the persona, the personification of who they are into what they want to be, was very interesting to me as subject, but also as something that connected in my mind with sort of theatrical, you know, the theatrical and how, what is theater, you know, ultimately, you know, that there's a presentation, projection, you could say, of a mask or of body armor, something protective or something, you know, horrible, you know, or crazy, or, you know, so that there's a projection of that that's outward, you know, a presentation. But that presentation is very important because it allows for the revelation of something else. You know, it allows for kind of the synthesis of what is underneath, that is buried or hidden, that is individual, that is particular. Mm-hmm. Never know exactly what that is. You know, because again, we never know anything. But it does begin to sort of reveal something of itself.
Right, bits and pieces.
Yeah, and it's in that sort of, in the particular, that I think the eye finds kind of interesting. In other words, it creates interest. It's how we think of also, you know, the general and the particular. Mm-hmm. You know, the universal nature of things, you know, and the temporal nature of things.
Right. Symmetry versus asymmetry.
I mean, I could get into a whole thing with that, but but there's
go for it. I find it interesting too. I was going to ask you about that actually, because in listening to and reading interviews from you and the few things I've been able to listen to, it seemed your general philosophy is based on that type. I don't know if balance is the right word for it, but it seems it's a constant, like you would say, you refer to like the temporal to the infinite and these kind of, what's the word I'm looking for? These bipolar aspects.
Well, it's, you know, kind of the idea of how we think about, you know, symmetry, you know, what is symmetry? You know, even painting a portrait,
right.
You know, we think about that there are symmetrical aspects to portrait, you know, how divided, you know, two eyes that are positioned symmetrically, nostrils, ears, and so forth. You know, just the whole body is divided, you know.
In a very general view.
Yeah. Kind of like one side to the other.
Right.
And that's a kind of, you know, there's that gives sort of balance to all the variety in terms of like the asymmetry that also coexists with that. So, you know, we look at one side of the face to the other, and one eye is a little higher, and one is a little lower. You know, nothing is purely symmetrical.
Right.
You know, there's also asymmetry, you know, in ourselves and forms of nature and so forth. So there's the sort of balance between how we see something in the whole and how we see something in the particular, you know. So that balance, that equilibrium between the parts and the whole is important to me,
right?
You know, and finding that sort of gray area. Now, some artists lean more towards the whole, you know, the universals and systems and the connectedness between, you know, one side to the other. And some artists lean more towards the particulars and the variations and the more morphic character of form.
Uh-huh.
So there's always like a kind of, you know, I mean, that, you know, like there's never really exactly a balance or any, you know, centered anything. Like there's no gray, there's no pure gray. It's always going to be on the side of, you know, one, either light or dark, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You never get to the center. So there, you can never really get to a true balance of anything. But the idea is that, suggest balance, you know, intimate, you know, the infinite. So the universal nature is something that we see at a distance. We see the whole, you know, we see the cyclical quality of things, you know. In other words, like you hold up a leaf from an oak tree, it echoes the shape of the oak tree. You hold up another leaf from that same oak tree, it's similar in shape and proportion. You look a little closer from one leaf to the other, all this variety, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So as soon as you start looking, the closer you begin to look, the more, you know, varied things become. And so very often I teach my students, you know, an observation to do both, you know, like look at the figure from a distance, gain its proportion, its position in space, you know, based on kind of a symmetrical outlook, how to see, you know, generalities, how those generalities, you know, could relate to a larger position in your thinking. But at the same time, you know, when we move close, those curvatures that we see at a distance become more and more angled. You know, we see more angles and more subtlety in those varied angles. And so things become more angular because our eye begins to sort of rest on the contour as a series of angles as opposed to a series of curves. And also how to think about the variety that exists to the eye and how to make that interesting and varied, but also connected to the larger picture, you know, the universal quality of a picture, you know, the feeling that everything belongs to everything, you know? So I say to my students that, like, you know, when you're looking, you know, looking at color, you know, don't just like look at one color, you know, but look at the variety of colors that exist in conjunction with each other, that there is no one color to anything. In fact, there is no color. There's only temperature, you know, and it's the variety of one temperature and value. I also say that, for example, that there's no such thing as separating value from color, but to think about color as value and value as color. And when you do that, then red is no longer red. Green is no longer green. You know, green, red is that red that you see, you know, is a certain temperature as it exists next to another red, or as it coexists next to.
Oh, I see. Yeah, the relationships and the
Yeah. So you could take, like Tony says, you can take like a red, you know, a cadmium red, and put it down next to, you know, cadmium or cadmium yellow, and that cadmium red all of a sudden starts to look cool.
Yeah.
You know, because it's overshadowed. Or you take that same cadmium red and you put it on a bright white background, you know, it starts to look dark.
Right.
It looks darker, you know. Take that same cadmium red and you put it on a vibrant blue, and all of a sudden it's lighter value.
Yep.
You know, all of a sudden it has chroma, you know, it just explodes to the eye dramatically, you know.
Yeah.
So the idea is that you know, everything is everything.
Right.
You know, everything is part of everything. You can't try not to isolate things, you know, but to see things in relation to each other. And so this is a this is what I think of as a symmetrical relationship.
That makes sense.
You know,
yeah.
You know, it's a relationship of establishing balances,
right?
Based on one to the other, one side to the other side. You
know, yeah.
One, what's on the inside, what's on the outside. Now you can also extend that to sort of like how we think about ourselves, how we think about others, how we think about our studio, how we think about the world outside. Mm-hmm. It becomes also a relationship, how we think about the world inside and how we think about the world outside. You know, what's on the inside, what's on the outside. You know, what's a curvature, what a series of angles.
Mm-hmm.
What's a detail, you know, how do we see the whole? How do we see the part? How do we see the whole? So there's you know, balance in that too. You know, there's a equilibrium or a sense of like seeing two things at once. And that's a very important concept for me, is that it's not that you see one thing and then you see the other, but it's seeing it all at once.
Right. Together in a relationship,
you know,
yeah.
Seeing the parts and the whole at once,
mm-hmm.
seeing the particulars and the general at once.
Right.
You know, And that takes a bit of effort too. I mean, I'm not saying that I'm great at it, but it is something that we all strive for, because the human mind, you know, the mind wants to like look at, focus in. Yeah. Yeah. So it's like, you kind of are, you know, you have to kind of fight your mind with your mind, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Painting and drawing is not a natural act.
No. Yeah. It's also, you know, developing a way of seeing something. Like, you know, I tell my students, you know, more than anything, it's like learning how to see that's important. You know, 90% of what we do is learning how to see. 10% maybe learning how to paint.
Right.
So you know, we're all still learning, you know, we're all learning how to see, you know, and that's all, you know, that's all part of the mystery of things too. But the act of seeing is something that requires a mindfulness towards, you know, it's not something that we take for granted. I mean, when I go around students and I say, hey, you know, I'll help them with, you know, their issues of color. A lot of people have trouble with color, seeing color.
Yeah.
You know, because most people are trained, especially in the genre that we paint in, most people are trained in seeing things first in values, seeing things, you know, in terms of value construct, you know, hierarchy of values and so forth.
That's not how you see it?
And no.
Okay.
No. You have to see both ways. I mean, like, you have, I mean, there is a hierarchy of value construct, but it's not to separate it from the from color, and to, or to separate from drawing. You know, that drawing, color, and, you know, it's all the same. You know, we have to see it. This is the thing. You know, it's like training your mind's eye to embrace everything, you know, at once. You know, how to see everything at once. You know, now if you paint it, you can paint it in a systematic way. You know, you could, there's nothing wrong with painting, like something in a grisaille technique or in an underpainting technique that is based on, you know, a limited palette idea. Or but in your mind, one has to sort of like see that as a prelude to what the painting will become. And in order to see something in the beginning, you know, the first steps are always like with the mindfulness that what I do now is based on what I will do. In other words, what I'm doing is not what I'm doing. It's what I'm about to do that matters.
Okay.
You know?
Yeah.
So whether it's a la prima approach or a indirect or direct painting approach, I mean, those are all terms. And basically, in the end, those are just semantics, you know, because everything that we do is everything has sort of a, I think a painting is a series of beginnings. In other words,
yeah,
nothing ever becomes finished. It only becomes made more complete. So people say, well, when do you know a painting is finished? You know, like, what is it that somebody asked Picasso, when, how do you know when a painting is finished? I said that, well, painting is painted by two artists paint a picture. You know, one of the artists has to hold the arm back.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, you know, I forgot exact words.
Yeah.
But I thought that, well, you know, and so, you know, one has to sort of know when to stop, you know?
Yeah.
Well, because it's true. I mean, like, you could go on forever and make it more and more, give it more and more the feeling of wholeness, mm-hmm. completeness, and so forth. But sooner or later, you know, it's like you have to say to yourself, okay, I got to stop.
Yeah.
You know? But is it finished? No.
Right.
You know, there's a story where one of Degas' collectors, well-known collector, the Rouart family, and he, Henry Rouart, not Rouault, Henry Rouart, mm-hmm. Went to, Degas came for dinner, and he's, one of his pictures was hanging. Can I borrow that back? I just want to change. I forget, maybe it was like the oil can on the corner of the painting. I just want to make a little change here, you know. And then he let him take it, which was his mistake. And then Degas turned it into just completely, you know, because one thing, little thing,
leads to another thing.
Little thing, yeah. Lead to another thing.
Yeah.
And so, you know, so for an artist, you know, and I look back at like paintings that I've done, like in, you know, like in the 80s or, you look back on an older painting and you go, oh my God, if I could only take that back into my studio and do it. You know?
Yeah.
You know, the feeling, I'm sure.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, definitely. Yeah. And I would imagine too, I mean, you're looking at paintings from so long ago, it's the more that distance grows, the more you've experienced more, you see better.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Those things are even more highlighted.
Yeah. Or you just, you change your mind, you know, you want to change your mind about something, or whether it's right or wrong, you know, whether you see things more correctly or less correctly.
Sure.
It's just that, you know, everything is moving, you know, we are moving, time is moving. I mean, when you're painting in your studio, I used to feel like everything had to be, you know, fixed. You know, tape the model, you still do that. But, you know, I think that getting older, to be an older artist, you're not so rigid about it. You know, that, you know, the light has to be a north light. You know, it has to be as steady as possible. You know, you have to keep the pose in check all the time. And I think that at least, you know, getting older, I begin to feel more like, well, you know, if the light changes a little bit, I'll go with it. You know?
Yeah.
If the model moves a bit, you know, sometimes I'll embrace that because it speaks to something that I might not have thought of. If I move back a little bit, you know, and I'm not in the exact same position, you know, maybe I see something that I wouldn't have otherwise seen. You know, if I turn my head a little bit one way or the other, you know, maybe hey, that gives me a little bit more feeling of the form turning, you know? So the being less kind of confined to creating a space that's very rigid and still allows for a breath, you know, a breath of possibilities that might not otherwise exist. And so that being, you know, as we mature, I think that more and more of that begins to sort of infiltrate the thinking.
Yeah. It know? Reminds me of one of my favorite Bruce Lee quotes when he just said, be like water, my friend.
Yeah.
You have to learn to
flexibility.
Adapt. Yeah.
How to adapt and be flexible.
Yeah. Water takes the shape of the bowl. Water takes the shape of the bottle.
Right. But it's also more powerful.
Yeah. And over time, it'll change rocks. Yes. And changes the shapes.
It's
of
also
rocks.
More powerful. Yeah. It's also more powerful.
Yeah.
You know, which I think is really flexibility. Very often I talk to my students and say, well, you know, like, you know, we have a strategy. You have a strategy before a picture. You know, sometimes that strategy is based on like a sketchbook, and I draw in my sketchbook both from my imagination and from my observation, and I'll incorporate, you know, like the combinations of things and start to maybe come up with a concept for a picture, you know, and I'll make some variations on that. And that's my strategy.
Yeah.
You know, that's kind of the strategy. That's kind of like the, what you do before you play a game of chess. You know, you get to know who your opponent is. You look at their, you know, what kinds of moves they've made, how they played the game before, and what you think a strategy might, you know, how to defeat them based on, you know, what you could expect from them, you know, based on what they've done already, you know? So you kind of like say, well, I can do this. I can do that. And then once you're in the game, you put your pawns out gradually. You don't put your queen out immediately, of course.
Right. Right.
You'll get killed. So that's like, you know, a lot of students, they put their queen out right away. They're looking at the detail of the eyeballs or the eyelashes or something, you know, they're like, you know, trying to go for the kill immediately. So, you know, by developing kind of a tentative, you know, a move, you're feeling out your opponent, you know, you kind of see where they're going. But then, you know, the opponent does something that you didn't expect them to do based on your expectations, you know. You might have an expect, you know, because everything that they've done before, you know, it's like, you know, it's not, they're not doing that. You know, there's something that just came out of nowhere, and it looks like there's no rhyme or reason. You can't figure it out. It looks like it's coming from something, you know, erratic, you know?
Yeah.
It feels erratic. It feels like it's a surprise, you know? Well, in painting, that's nature, you know, and nature is what you see out and what you see in. Mm-hmm. It's the relationship between who you are, how you feel, what you've become, and what the world, the appearances of the world are simultaneous to that. So what do? You know, well, you have to be like water. You know, you have to be flexible.
Yeah.
So one has to sort of like change the strategy, you know, or change something of your strategy in order to adapt to the unexpected, you know, that move that challenges you, you know, and that painting in many ways can be that, you know, and that's the excitement to me in painting. It's like having a really good opponent, you know, an opponent who, because if you have a weak opponent, you know, yeah, sure, get through it, you know, really quickly, but having a really good opponent, you know, challenges, you with the unexpected, with how to respond to something
right
that you wouldn't otherwise be able to. Does that make sense?
No, that makes perfect sense. I was wondering too, and I guess we'll start tying it up. But with regards to that, like if taking like a kind of a bird's eye view, I guess, in the trajectory of your life in painting, what would you say is changed, like with regards to like the value of painting, and how do you see realist painting, I guess I would say. And what I mean by that more specifically is like in my short time in painting, it always seems anything that's somewhat realist seems to go in and out of fashion. The market changes. And I remember even in the beginning, like say maybe in the 90s, it almost seemed kind of anachronistic. Like traditional oil painting was almost kind of this like, oh, isn't that neat? And then it comes back into the public consciousness, and then it's elevated to an extent.
I remember there was a time when oil painting, no matter what one's outlook was, whether it was representational or non-representational, was kind of looked down on.
Uh-huh.
You know? And that, you know, some of our art critics at the time, I'm talking about like, especially in the 90s, would elevate, you know, photography over painting, you know, I'm not even talking, I mean, you know, even formalist paintings, you know, was looked at as being, when I say formalist, I mean, you know, non-objective painting.
Mm-hmm.
Were looked at as being kind of passé, you know, that painting itself was really like a mode or a medium that you know, didn't really have any meaning anymore, consequences of were meaningless. So there was a very strong outlook for that. So the emphasis was primarily on, video and photography and performance art.
Mm-hmm.
So, and painting was sort of like put on the back burner, you know, I mean, of course artists painted, of course they were exhibited in all kinds, you know, but realist painting or figurative painting, you know, was the term was very often used as being retrograde.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't hear that much anymore, you know, that term retrograde.
No.
Which I think is kind of interesting, you know, like why call it retrograde? Like what the hell does that mean, you know? Anyway. So that sort of point of view was very powerful at that time, and I think that it's changed. I think that painting has now become more elevated, actually, over many of the other mediums, as you know, for as painting. But unfortunately, I think that the emphasis seems to be less on, how should I say this, like less on the particulars with regard to the meaning of a picture and the point of the purpose of painting, and it's been made more into a commodity.
Mm-hmm.
So the sort of objectification of painting has become more important than the content of a painting, at least in the world, the way I see it, you know, in the upper echelons of the art world. So the, you know, its value, it's become a little bit more like a trophy or an antiquity, you know, that has, you know, how value is associated with it as an object, as opposed to, it's dynamic as a form. And I think that's unfortunate, not just because it's, whether it's figurative or not non-figurative. I think, you know, I mean, it could be, I mean, painting could be anything, and I can enjoy all kinds of painting. But it's just unfortunate that's kind of like the world we live in, where, you know, where people who buy art aren't educated, you know, majority. A lot of celebrities who buy art, you know, aren't cultivated, you know, with a deep knowledge of art history, or are cultivated with an understanding of painting. Not everyone, but to a large degree, there's a kind of a commercialized outlook that to me is unfortunate. So, I mean, as far as like actual representational painting, you know, real you know, what becomes titled representational art. There's all kinds of ways in which people, you know, terms that people use for that. What's realist, what's not, you know, what's naturalist or what's objective. I mean, you know, I'm not sure how to classify that. I just only know what I enjoy, what I like, what I want. I've always enjoyed, I can't remember a time when, you know, the great artists from the museums, like, didn't speak to me, you know? I mean, I just, I've always had this sort of, like, deep, like love for Titian, for Rembrandt, for Velasquez, for, you know, Michelangelo, for Raphael. I mean, Delacroix. I mean, like, mm-hmm. There's just so much there that I've always, like, felt connected to, not just because of the, you know, because everybody says that they're great artists, but because they kind of like touch me in my deepest part of my soul,
right?
You know, and so I wanted to be part of that. You know, I want my work to be connected somehow to that.
You see that as a lineage, of sorts.
Actually, can I read? I came across there's a quote here,
yeah,
by Francis Bacon. If I can just read it, just
please.
Kind of, it's interesting. It's very 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 meaningful, I think. But he says, also, man now realizes that he is an accident, that he is a completely futile being, that he has to play out the game without reason. I think that even when Velasquez was painting, even when Rembrandt was painting, they were still, whatever their attitude to life, slightly conditioned by certain types of religious possibilities, which man now, you could say, has had canceled out for himself. Man now can only attempt to beguile himself for a time by prolonging his life, by buying a kind of immortality through the doctor. You see, painting has become, all art has become, a game by which man distracts himself. And you may say that it always has been like that, but now it's entirely a game. What is fascinating is that it's only going to become much more difficult for the artist, because he must really deepen the game to be any good at it all, so that he can make life a bit more exciting.
That's a great quote.
Yeah. And I think that, like, the idea of sort of making art into entertainment, I think has kind of, like, in our day, or at least in our contemporary experience with the art world, you know, that really speaks to that, I think, because entertainment in many ways is what kind of distracts us, you know.
Of course,
it distracts us from, you know, the possibility of death, or the inevitability of death, and so it's kind of like, you know, what we have is this game, you know, because we don't have that deeper struggle with faith and doubt that maybe artists of the past had. So what we're left with is simply the game, you know, and that, I think, you know, it can be good, and it can be a problem, you know, because for me, at least my outlook on things is that when I look back at the great artists of the past, it's not because they painted representationally, or because they had great skill, or because they did, or because they had, you know, even, you know, human compassion exhibited in their work, or some moral, you know, empathy. It's not just because of that. I do love the idea of craft, of good craftsmanship, and I love to look at, you know, great drawing and all of that, but really what the underlying, I think, the underlying connection that I've had ever since I was a little kid, you know, to looking at Michelangelo or looking at Leonardo da Vinci or looking at these artists, is that kind of questioning of not only spirituality but questioning of existence that that seems so deep and illuminating. That's why I love those artists so much, and why I want to paint like them.
I think that is a perfect way to end it. That was really beautiful. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
And I wanted to touch back. You were talking earlier now that during quarantine, you're doing, what was it? You said critiques and instruction online?
Or I am. Yes. I've started to do, I'm actually in the middle of it. Every Wednesday, I'm doing a workshop for the New York Academy where I'm a senior critic and instructor. And so I have a class that I do for them, you know, where we're all doing self-portraits, uh-huh. Since the majority of people only have themselves now to paint. And then I also am doing private critiques with people who want to, you know, show their work to me. And either it could be a one-time critique where I give them, you know, a fresh eye or point of view. Or it could be an ongoing session of critiques where I could provide them with a, you know, challenge or a project that they could work on over a period of time.
Okay.
And so, you know, yeah, and it's been going well. I've got people from all over really the world doing it with me. And it's been an interesting challenge, not only, I think for those people participating, but I think for myself, because I think that when you teach, you're not just teaching others, but you're teaching yourself.
Totally. 100% agree.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
where do people find out more about that? Can they go to your website? Do they email you directly?
They could find that information on my web. Not so much. I don't think I have it on my website, actually. I have it on Facebook and Instagram right now.
Oh, okay, perfect. And I'll,
yeah, so
I'll
they could go to my
show notes too.
Oh, thank you. They could go to my Instagram page and find my assistant there if you fill them in.
Oh, okay.
Perfect. Yes.
Okay.
My assistant is Valerie Duncan. Yes.
Yeah. Okay, perfect. I'll include all that in the show notes.
Right, thank you.
And Stephen, thank you for taking the time. I mean, again, I really appreciate it.
Music for the podcast is by Rarebit, aka Justin Dosher Hopkins. Editing assistance is by Noah Wainwright, and intern is Sam King.